On this happy note, Uzi.
I apologize, I would speak in Hebrew, but I would explain to our English-speaking friends here why I choose Hebrew. In 8 minutes, you can have more mileage in Hebrew than in English. Fewer words get more content. אז אני עובר לשפה הטובה והנוחה והיעילה העברית. Exuberance, התלהבות יתר, אם יש מישהו ש... אולי עלול להיות מואשם בהתלהבות יתר, זה אני בעצמי.
Exuberance, it's me, because among... My sins, there's a document from 40 years ago that I wrote when I was a young researcher in the Hudson Institute that it says for the Ministry of Defense in the United States, and the name was U.S. Energy Independence. And your humble servant, in a very impressive table I saw, like between 74 and 80, if you only want, you can bring United States not to be dependent on external sources of oil, because the shock of 73 showed that America does. So what can a state can send somebody to the moon? It decides that in 1980 it's going to be completely independent, and then they do the following thing. They show how all the curves are growing, more split mining of carbon, more nuclear energy, more use of oil from sources that are not OPEC, North Sea, Canada, etc. More than all of that, you can show up to 1980, if you do everything decisively, you have energy independence. So we wrote it down. And now I must admit that it wasn't exactly a non-biased piece of paper, because we saw it in Israeli eyes. And by the way, that was the criticism I received even then, because the Israeli interest was transparent from the point of view of Israel at the time. The United States and a world that is dependent on Arab oil, that doubles and trebles the prices of oil. It was $3 a barrel at the time. It went up to 10 those good old days. But that, of course, contributes to two problems. One, to a sense of dependence on the Arab oil supply, what we used to call the oil weaponry, and also a huge financial dependence on these countries, which, of course, is a heavy burden, especially after the War of Yom Kippur. So this should be the will of the United States to release itself from this dependence, and actually the whole Western world should be released from the OPEC Middle Eastern oil, and will develop either other sources or oil which is not oil. That was the ambition, natural, which also reflected the Israeli interest, and therefore we could have been exuberant as much as we wanted. There's only one problem. It did not happen, of course. And why didn't it happen? For very good reasons. It did not happen even when the price of oil was five times higher. So you talk about incentives to produce sources that before were not lucrative, all of a sudden they became lucrative. But nevertheless, the rise of prices did not bring about a turnaround or any real reduction, a strategic reduction. It did not happen. Okay, a lot of oil streamed down the line and a lot of water under the bridge, and we come to the reality of today. The question is whether American exuberance at the moment of its being dependent on its oil energies, is that better? Is that important? Is that better? Is it worthwhile? All the comments that we just heard, I of course agree, but I just want to add a few things. First of all, the circumstances changed. The Arabs are not the same Arabs. Their hostility against us that was very problematic in 73 is not the same. At the time it was translated to a real heavy burden regarding the Palestinian issue. Today, unfortunately, the Palestinians are not leveraging the Arab impact. Nobody is very enthusiastic by them. They have their own sources, but that's not nothing to do with the Arab oil or the import of Arab oil. On the other hand, the American dependence and the level of involvement of the United States in the Middle East is already not so much anchored on oil considerations, at least not directly. To a great extent, there are two exaggerations in the history regarding the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. One is that the American policy is impacted by oil and that it has to do with the Zionist lobby. Both things are exaggerated. But what about the first one? The United States never acted in the Middle East because of oil considerations. That wasn't the dominant consideration. If you look as a test case, in what situation did the United States did the ultimate difficult thing, using force? How much of the events that it acted in this region in one way or another were motivated by the concern about the oil sources? Almost nil. In the last decade, let's say the great and destroy at the moment against ISIS, it's all anchored at the fact that this force is a force that devastates, kills. And against this application of violence, the United States intervenes. There's no direct consideration or even indirect that ISIL has to do anything with oil income. That's besides the point. But this is a classic political consideration. In Afghanistan, why did the United States intervene with boots on the ground? That was a result of what happened in the United States, but it's a completely different product, not oil and gas, but violence. This is the real expertise that the Middle East exports in great quantities to the West. That's why the United States started acting in Afghanistan and later on in Iraq. Although people will say that the reason was to bring the news of democracy, let's not be deluded. Other reasons. Look at the phenomenon that happened just a year ago. It's just a precedent, as if the United States withdrew from the region, the Obama regime, a precedent, and in a context that nobody ever did, it comes close to force. Because the Syrians used chemical weapons against their own population. No American interest was jeopardized. No American was killed or hurt. How come altogether Kerry and Obama, all of the time, sudden take a posture and going to punish the Syrians for something that they didn't do? And you know, the legalists, you know, they didn't breach any or violate any law. You know, the Geneva Agreement is only the use of chemical weaponry against other countries, not against your own population. And that's an excuse that America used in the 80s in order to take steps against Iraq, which was its ally. So what do they care if they use it against their own population? Whereas the convention is not to develop nuclear weapon, and Syria did not sin in that either. No violation. What it did, it wasn't very nice. But the United States now takes upon itself a mission of policing with a certain state that it kills 1,000 people with a chemical weapon. It takes force against it, but we saw it happening. If there wasn't some sort of the Americans would create a precedent that they never did, and that's interesting in itself. So the direction is towards using force in this context or today, another context where the United States threatens potentially is nuclear of various tools, but it's nothing to do with the oil. In other words, the energy considerations, the only place that you can see perhaps is the first Gulf War, when the United States thought for a second that there is a possibility that Iraq will continue the invasion from Kuwait towards Syria, and that's why it was also a defensive issue. But later on, when the United States went to attack, it went to release Kuwait and to put borders back in order, and the consideration was more political and military rather than defending the oil line. So in other words, anybody who thinks that the situation of self-image of American independence from Middle Eastern oil sources not only doesn't happen, but it can take a price from Israel by detaching the United States from its commitment to the Middle East is mistaken. The United States will remain. You hear this reasoning, for example, where do the rumors come from that as if there's energetic independence and it's good news? You hear it from people who want to justify the United States to isolate itself and withdraw itself from dealing in the world altogether and in the Middle East in particular. But still, this is just an excuse. And if they want to do it, they're going to do it anyway. That's not a real excuse. That's not a real reason. But in general, I don't see it happening because maybe the United States is losing interest in the Middle East, but the Middle East is not losing interest in the United States. And the factors that make the United States act diplomatically, military and security are completely different and have nothing to do. This is not the motive. But aspects of oil, side issues of energy do exist here. And I will conclude by saying that there are aspects. If this is true, and it is true, that in the strategic battle is still even and beyond the consideration of America, how do you fight against ISIS and again the Iranian becoming nuclear? There's a whole maneuvering area, but still you have to cope with Iran that's becoming nuclear. And here, before you consider, like Amos alluded, that if they will come to a situation in June or July that there'll be a dead end, and you take out of the closet all the possibilities and other leverages, and that's of course by the United States as well, then there's a whole scope here in oil to say that because of the energy of Iran, there's relative benefit to the general goal. Here, oil and anybody who's dependent on oil or gas is Iran, and the use of this maneuvering here is against Iran as a leverage, as a pressure, and I think they'll use it. If in July there's a dead end, then what has to come is a more rigidness and more sanctions, economical sanctions in energy, and to take advantage of the fact that the prices went down, and that dependence in Iran will be enhanced, and that's the right use, instrumental, but that's not the main factor, that's not the main motivation, and in those fronts, Israel and the United States are at the same side of the fence.